the Senate was deciding whether we should stick to the letter that was sent in terms of me asking the questions and then me also preempting some other questions that might be asked. So since we've gone down this road, let me start by saying when we walked into Public Works the middle of September last year, there was an $83 to $85 million debt. Ongoing works. That is monies that the government of Liberia owed the very contractors, Senator Johnson, that you're talking about today. Not new works, not works that this administration would start. Ongoing works, which means when I got in the house, when I walked in the house the first day, there was a bill waiting for me. And that has impacted our relationship with the contractors. We moved forward to January of this year. We learned when we got to Public Works, despite the price tag, existing bill of $83 to $85 million, that the Ministry of Finance had appropriated, and my deputy minister is here, so if I misquote the amount, I humbly ask you to let him correct me, that we had gotten a budget for $21 million. And the budget for $21 million included our addressing of the ongoing works, which as I stated earlier was $83 to $85 million, and $3 million for works. And they called it maintenance. And that's what we would have used to do works in all 15 counties. It didn't matter if we're patching a pothole, it didn't matter if we're trying to pave Robertsport to Medina, it didn't matter if we're doing something in the southeast, in the northeast and northwest, $3 million. In January of this year, the $3 million that we would have gotten to do any kind of works, which as you all have stated, you might have seen public works somewhere, was rolled into what was paid the contractors. $14.6 million was paid to some contractors. And by some, you know, it's actually interesting, Mr. Senator, when you said the contractors come to public works and we say we're not paying you. Public works has the responsibility of providing the technical oversight. Based on the certification of works, Public Works tells the Ministry of Finance these works have been done. Given the situation and things were very slow, and the fact that the contractors were asking for their money, this, my administration, along with, in collaboration with the Ministry of Finance, we submitted to them the list of all of the certificates that were due to be paid. These were certificates that were prepared and approved by the ministry effective April 31st, 2013. Just as a point of clarification, we arrived at Public Works the middle of September 2013. So that was the cutoff. Because even after that time, there were some contractors that came and they said, you need to include me in the payment scheme. But that was the cutoff, that was the criteria. Based on that, the spreadsheet showing a list of some 34 projects for payments to consultants and contractors were sent to finance, totaling about $34 million. And that is, if the government had the money, they would have paid for all of those works completed that had already been certified by the ministry I inherited before I walked in the door, and would have paid $34 million. And I grant you, every contractor and consultant probably would be happy. The Ministry of Finance paid $14.6 million. The Ministry of Finance also decided which contractors and consultants it would pay. We have a copy of a letter, our recommendation to the Ministry of Finance, where we said, look, it's 34 different projects. Of the 34 different projects, about 11 of them were less than $250,000. So we made a recommendation, call them small contractors. Pay everybody up to $250,000. That would alleviate a larger percentage of the payment. Everybody else, 251 and above. I mean, we understand we're not financial people, so we made a recommendation of a formula. You got the total amount, if you will, of the $34 million. You've got the amount that's due to each contractor over $250,000. We said take a ratio. Take a ratio of what that amount is to the total, get a percent. And whatever amount of money you make available, use that percentage, you will pay everybody something. We got information back from the Ministry of Finance that they came up with a different model. Interestingly, today, we're accused of deciding which contractor got paid. Absolutely, categorically, not true. So the situation we have today as to why I am hampered calling a contractor to go on a road and do some works is because that has impacted our relationship. So what we need, you know, you bring out the issue of the Southeast. I don't want to say I'm half sleepless nights because I'm thinking I'm too young to go gray right now. No disrespect intended. Honorable House Senate. Public Works currently has three contracts along the corridor from Buchanan via Riverside to Sino to Grand Cru. We got companies along that corridor signed contracts. A portion of the road from via Riverside going to Sino. We've got a contract with another company from Greenville to Bartleyville, and then we've got a contract, and these are existing contracts that existed as of last year when we entered the ministry. So these weren't new contracts. We had a chance to visit the Southeast in March. You know, I really wish we had an opportunity to show you some of the pictures, some of what we saw based on contracts we paid for. Based on corridors, we've said contractors have completed 65% of the works. For me, that's a bit of a disappointment. So if I have an opportunity, maybe in another setting, to show you all some of this, because you know there's a saying, a picture is worth a thousand words. As a result of that, realizing, much like the senator said, and much like many of you are concerned, that we will have a serious issue on our hands for 26, more so than we have now. We had to come back and it's like, look, we got to do this differently. As a result, we had to bring pressure more so on the contractors than were there before. These are the contractors along that corridor. You have got to perform. I went to the Southeast and on portions of the road, I saw culverts that looked like speed bumps. Senator Cooper, and I'm sorry, Senator Cooper, to try to point you out, but Senator Cooper was also in the Southeast in March. And given his background in construction, he raised his concerns to me as well.
That the Ministry of Public Works told the Nipah County for the use of our yellow machine on the primary road in 2012. We have an MOU between the Ministry of Public Works and Nipah County to pay this money. But up to the present, the money has not been paid. I want to know from you, Madam Minister, what is the status of this money and what your ministry is doing to settle this, you know, with Nipah County, because mostly this money was for our fuel, you know, for the fuel that we use on the primary road. Thank you.
Information?
But who left the
co-chair for the Nipah County, told all the parents that I have taken that money.
Oh, wow.
I have the paper.
We'll do our best to answer the question. Senator Groupie, you're absolutely right. In fact, I distinctly recall during my confirmation hearing, you informed me about the issue of this MOU between Public Works and Nipah County, which by definition would imply that it yet again is something we inherited. So we will do our best to explain to you what we're doing to try to make sure that Nipah gets its money back. When you met with me and officials of the ministry in February of this year, and you're right, we're almost running out of the 5 months, which is why you kind of want to be cautious in this line of work to give a date, because sometimes that date comes back to haunt you. And
the question is, do you own Nipah?
Based on the MOU I met at Public Works, Senator Pro Tem, it does appear that the ministry owes Nipah County because there was an MOU signed. by the former Deputy for Technical Services and the former Superintendent of Nimba County for equipment. So Senator Johnson, honestly, I know nothing about what you're talking about, but the truth is, I find myself in many instances nowadays not knowing enough about what I should know. So it's clearly something we should work on. But there is the MOU, and Senator Gruppi, what I do, based on the information made available, there was also a budget line item that was included by, you know, some of my predecessors in the budget for the ministry for this fiscal period. And there's been no appropriations. We've been unable to pay it. What we've done is included again in the next fiscal budget. And we've made it very clear, because one of the issues I raised to you, and this almost goes back to what Senator Johnson was saying, if you ruin your relationships, you can't go back. Because I even though I wasn't there, I imagine there was a reason that Public Works had to go to Nimba County to use their road equipment. And if we find ourselves in that situation again, we can't actually predict what the Nimba caucus will do. We've included this. This is a matter that we've had extensive conversations with the Ministry of Finance. I mean, if at this point in time it's going to come back, I don't think we're questioning the validity of this, because we met it there as we did meet other contracts, and we've been charged with the implementation and management of these contracts. So what I would say to you, we will continue to do our best, because it is somewhat shaming us, because if any of my predecessors signed these and inherited it, it's under the umbrella of the ministry. So there is a signed MOU for that. I'm not aware of any relationship with Senator Johnson, to the best of my knowledge. However, same here, other than the newspaper. I didn't go to Elm. That was my uncle. And Senator Gruppi, the other issue was the road. And you're right, given the timeline that we projected in February, it does seem like we're running out of that 5 months effective next month. The reconstructed timeline, if you will, is shifting us now to sometime between October to November, during the start of the dry season. And we certainly hope that all of the necessary logistical procurement, design issues that, you know, clarifications from the donor, Mittal Steel, and all of what we have to do will be done to ensure that we can at least keep this timeline. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Minister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Presiding. And I'd like to, even though he's not here, thank my colleague from Bonny. Raising the issue that relates to the holding of independence in Samuel and Grand Group, and I'm happy that the minister alluded to the series of problems that she's facing along those corridors. Because the only thing here, Madam Minister, is that when we go to this steering committee, national steering committee meeting for the independence, Public Works is not there. Nobody represents Public Works. Nobody is there articulating Public Works. We're talking about building public buildings, doing this one, doing that one. But how do we get there? The trucks that were moving material on get stuck for 3 weeks. They can't move. You alluded to the fact the difficulties we encountered the last time when the president went up to Sandra and Grand Cru. Okay? But the issue, I remember we had a meeting, the Grand Cru caucus with you, and you claimed that the Ministry of Finance is not giving you the funding, and you have been taking notes of what you say, you know, 33 million should have been paid, they paid 14%, they selected who they had to select, you know. All of these things present serious impediment to the holding of independence in the southeastern part of this country. You know very well that there are bridges that need to be redone. If Solid Rock in the Riverside Corridor has stopped, if Atlanta Resource between Greenville and Bagotville has stopped, if SSF that is on the Bagotville Conway Camp Road has stopped, then we're not going to hold any independence.
You know?
And I think it is important, Madam Minister, that while we are preparing the invitations for dignitaries, we are preparing all the different awards and things that are going to be accolades that are going to be given to people. We're not working on the roads. You already said now you are afraid that you're going to get gray hair from this independence. And I warned you during your confirmation. I said that was going to be your greatest challenge as Minister of Public Works. And it is happening. But we need to have an independence, whether we like it or not. Okay? A lot of money is being pumped into other things. It doesn't mean to say money is not there. Just the other day, the steering committee came, some 600,000 GSAs went out to do some different things. So it's possible to find the money, to give some money, as you said, 250,000 to each one of these contractors so that they'll be able to get fuel and things to move the roads and make it pliable for the independence. But somebody has to preach Public Works case, you know? And I think the caucus is waiting for the Sanamu and Granville caucuses are waiting for the president to return. We need to have a summit on this road issue. If we're going to have this independence in Granville, if it's not possible, let's go to Centennial Pavilion and forget about Granville, you know, and Sanamu. But if we intend to have it, we must sit down and decide on the issue of these roads. If we cannot do the roads, then no need. Let's forget about it. But, Madam Minister, you the minister, I'm just a senator from Grand Cru, you know. But you the minister, you need to find solutions. That's why we made you minister. That's why we confirm you. You need to ensure that the roads from here, the corridor from Bassa to Riverside to Sino to Grand Cru, are pliable. You know, you will have to find a solution. You can't run away from it. You know, they say you can't stand the heat, don't go in the kitchen. You in the kitchen and you got to stand the heat and find this money, sit down with the Minister of Finance. So my question to you, how do you intend to do this? Well, because we got 2 more months. If independence is not held, all the blame will go on you. I know everybody will say public work, and we'll show them through the grid that you don't want to grow.
That's your money.
Yeah, but so, Madam Minister, you got to tell us. I'm sure my colleague from Sino, all of us, are eager.
I will buttress you.
Yes, sir. You know that. How do you intend to dismantle this enigma, this difficulty that you have? Because you are the person charged with responsibility to do it.
Let me have my own depressing situation. Then she will
Please, let us introduce
yes,
and then we'll come back to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So that we don't want someone to be the platoon in the place that I get as I want. I don't let you sleep. I'm capable that you're looking for.
Madam Minister,
you're looking for capable for her.
Don't worry.
Last week, Saturday, I left from here and went to Sino. And I came back yesterday and I traveled on the road. From my experience on that road yesterday, I am convinced that July 26th celebration may not take place in Sino. I'm convinced about it. Unless God intervenes.
Yeah.
I got somewhere between Atia and Jitro on the south side. There's a place there that is totally damaged. Cars cannot easily pass through. All the cars I met them stop at 2 hours stop. A greater there, but the men from Solid Rock The man came to me and said, Senator, for the past 2 to 4 months, no pay. We are just here. If I don't have fuel to move the equipment, I said, okay, but you get some there.
To move it?
He said, yes. I said, okay, take this amount of money, use that fuel, then you buy more fuel. But please, take all the cars out from the mall. That's how serious it is. Then there are two bridges, wooden bridges along the road. You talk about that road, imagine. Now, will those bridges be in that kind of condition to carry international guests through that road to Sino and Grand? No, for us that we can sleep.
No, we don't want to sleep.
For me, we are used to it. But the guests, I mean, this is very serious. Well, you see, what makes our case serious, Madam Minister, is the way you are treating us. That makes it even more frustrating. Senator Coleman came for a meeting with you and gave me your number. He gave me your number. And immediately I called in his presence. The phone rang. You didn't pick up the phone.
Now we don't want a political obligation to pick up the phone.
You didn't pick up the phone, the minister? Because of this thing, the road situation. And why we are talking the way we are talking before I end, Madam Minister, we are the politicians. We are the leaders of our people. They don't see you.
If I can't see me, they will see you.
They can't see you. So they see us every day. Then they bother us. They ask us questions. A question we cannot answer. Then what kind of leaders are we? The people came to me in Greenville. By the time I woke up, my house was full of several citizens. What question were they asking? Senator, you think the 26th will come here? And I couldn't answer them. Because even GSA, I don't know what kind of project. Well, that was not your area.
You know that road that you talk about?
Yes. So, Madam Minister, please, that 27 must have failed to go to the southeast. If it fails, I'll put a blame on you. Yes. Because if you were meeting with us, if we were discussing, then we all will find ideas how to do these things. But you become, I don't know. So please, change the way you run your office. Yeah, when we come, when we call you, answer us. I beg you. Yeah, I'm begging for it because we are in a government of coordination.
Yes.
We have to coordinate.
Yes.
I don't want to go into areas where major streets connecting counties, the sins of counties will be paved. Now, I have been hearing the pavement will start before the end of this regime, but I'm hearing you talk about 2030. Yeah, it's a 2030 vision. Yeah. But before 2030, by that time, most of us, it will be alive, will be old, very old. But before we get to that 2030 now, why are we starting? What is the national blueprint? What is the national plan? I will talk about plan, so that I misunderstood. But I mean it. How will we say we pave all the major streets connecting cities in this country without a plan? How do we begin that process? It is the plan we use to allocate money in the budget that we use to look for resources to begin. I wonder where you have that plan, Madam Minister. I wonder seriously. So every time I hear that, certain streets will be paid, I say, thank God. So please, make sure. Send your engineers on the road. That one of the things that the engineers should not sit down in Monrovia. Yes.
That ministry is a ministry for this country. That should build this country. They should sit down in Moravia. I was on that road last night. Why they can't go there too to see what is happening to our people? Please, Madam Minister, when we come to your office, see us here. I beg you. You are our Minister of Public Works. That's what we go to you for. To tell you, you may not have solutions to all our problems. You may not have the funding, but at least receive us and talk to us. Then we go back to our people and they ask us questions. Then we know what to say. Thank you for coming. Always be coming, yeah?
Right now, there are three corridors, and three contracts, as you said, along that corridor.
Huh?
And there are three road contracts along the corridor. As a matter of fact, Senator Nangwe, the specific corridor you talked about starting at ITI, it's a $7.2 million contract, 107 kilometers between Yimba Junction and Yonkers Town. That contract was slated to be completed December of this year. You're right, as a part of that contract, there are four wooden bridges that should have been done as reinforced bridges. You're absolutely right. It appears to be a contract that wasn't managed properly, because if it had, those bridges would have been done this dry season. We wouldn't be having that conversation right now. As a result of what we saw in March, this is why the ministry redoubled its efforts, put people here. The issue that Senator Coleman raised, it's actually a real issue. This is something, while we may not have all the answers for why, we've been informed in writing by the three major contractors along that corridor, Solid Rock, SSF, and Atlantic Resources, about the difficulties they were having in dealing with the logistical and procurement issues as it related to the contract, because they were having issues with lines of credit from the bank as a result of a conversation that was had between the Minister of Finance and the banks and the contractors. While you're absolutely right, it is a headache. It's a nightmare we have inherited. But let's all understand that headache and nightmare did not start today. And we're trying to find ways to deal with it. And one of the nightmares of the Coleman, as we alluded to, is how do we address this issue of the contractor? These are not new contractors. These are our contractors that are there that we had to get. You mentioned Solid Rock. Since you mentioned Solid Rock by name, we will have to, we will certainly go back there. Solid Rock, as a result of when we left in March, had to not only redouble, had to triple, had to quadruple, had to 100 times their effort along that road. Here's a contract that, like I said, based on the 2-year duration of that contract should be ending in December. All of those bridges should have been done. But when you walk into a ministry, and call this my criticism of my own ministry, because these are the things we have to change, then you have a $7.2 million contract that's devoid of a scope of work, of specifications, even designed for the very same bridges you're talking about. It speaks volumes of the nightmare that we have to change, and change will not come easy. Because a part of the change will have to bring to change the capacity. You talked about the engineers being on the road. Ironically, several months ago, the president showed up at the ministry. And the president, as my boss, he's known for doing that. I happened to be in the field that morning. Ironically, I was accused of being absent from work. So you gave an example of, yeah, we are engineers in the field. You know, it's almost, senators, rather respectfully, it's kind of damned if you do. It's damned if you don't. No disrespect intended. It is a serious matter. The matter along that corridor was so serious that there were concerns, because here's the bottom line. Out of the $7.2 million contract for Solid Rock, the government has paid about $5 million. Now you tell me, senators, I'm looking for answers. How do we recoup the money? The certificate of completion I met at Public Works stated Solid Rock had done 65% of that work. Senator Coleman was just there. Senator Cooper was just there. I tell you, when I got there, I didn't see 65%. Even the percentage we did see, the quality was substandard. And yes, let me go on record and say it was substandard. So these are the challenges. Now, it's like you're back against the rock in a hard place. So we call the contractor in. The contractor looks in the face and says, he can do it. I'm like, I don't want the platitudes. We not only need a clear plan, a recovery plan of how you're going to do it, we need to quadruple our efforts to make sure that we bring the kind of supervision and oversight. Because we also recognize it's as much on the side of the minister as it is on the side of the contractor. This has to be a relationship for it to work. We cannot leave the contractors and consultants to their own design. Because if you sign a contract with someone, human agents and such, if you don't bring the kind of supervision to bear, they will give you what you think you want. So we recognize these are areas that we have to address. If we're going to have resident engineers in the fields and engineers, we have to have the level of confidence, senators, that they have the capacity. And the reality is, the capacity is substandard. And that's the reality. So some of the game change will be people change. And this is the support we will want from you. Because to get the kind of roads you want, to get the kind of bridges we all want and deserve, we'll have to make the hard choices. And we've made a commitment to do everything we can to ensure that we all get to sign it, that we all get the grant. It's not going to be an easy job. In fact, it's going to be a nightmare. Right now, as far as the corridor from also, which will give us some type of relief, this is a collaboration between FDA and the Ministry of Finance and a couple of works. We have some local concessions along that road, similar to land resources in Grand Cru. There's some local concessions between Buchanan and Greenville. I'm sorry, Buchanan and, let's say, Riverside. So what we've done right now is they had actually reached out to the government. You know, they're willing to do certain portions of the work. Starting, right, we now have to make sure that work is designed and engineered substantially, because they're not doing it for free. It's going to reflect tax incentives and credits from the government. So while the government may not pay the money up front, the government, which you and I are part of, has to pay the money on the back end. So these are other things we have to intensify. You know, but like many things, they started, they did the work, and they sent me a paper to sign, and said, we can't sign it. We can't sign it because we got to make sure this work, this government gets value for its money. They weren't very happy about it. But I'll say this, and I'll say it publicly. If I'm going to sign something, when I sign something, senators, it will be corrected. We must ensure that the government, the country, gets value for its money. As a result of that, the issue with the contractors is a serious one. We've written the Ministry of Finance. As a matter of fact, we've called in Senator Coleman. We've called in the three major contractors along that corridor. Atlantic Resources, Solid Rock, and SSF. They've told us about their concerns. They've written us. We've met with the Minister of Finance. We've written them letters. We even tried to escalate it and copy our letters to the Ministry of State. So even at the highest office, we're all aware of this. Senator Coleman, when I last met here with him and Senator Waterson, they brought up that issue and we talked about it. As recently as last week, we made that very clear. This is a serious matter. The issue you're talking about is an existing contract. This was a contractor, incidentally, who was a part of the contractors that were paid in January. That brought that contractor up to 65%. But notwithstanding, this is a situation they're saying that if they're hampered getting the lines of credit from the bank. It's not that they're bringing completed works to us. The catch 22 here is they can't get the money. They're having trouble getting the money. So they can't finish the work. We can't certify the work, and we can't submit the finance for payment. So now we do have to find a way to deal with this vicious cycle, because before we know it, it will be June 26. And we're very painfully aware of this reality. And you know, we do apologize if many of you didn't know this, but a part of coming here when you summon me, like I told my team, that there are things that the senators have not asked for, but I can guarantee you it will come up. Because we expected some of these issues to be raised. And you know, so whatever leverage you might be able to use, and we're not just talking to the senators from Grand Cru and Simon. This is something that impacts the entire country. You give the example, Senator, about the dignitaries and the guests. I'm as concerned about our guests and dignitaries as I am concerned about everyone in this room, be they a senator, be they Joe Public. We all have to get it. So we have to find a way. Ironically, we've got contracts along this road. So we don't have to go looking for new contracts. And all three of these contractors, I believe, and I'll get my deputy to correct me, I believe they were also paid in the round of payments in January. So we, based on the works completed, that had been taken care of. At least a percentage of it, unlike some other contractors. But the issue that was brought to our attention, as has been written by the three contractors, as we've passed on in writing to finance, as we've met with them, it's a serious issue. You have the kind of latitude over the banking institutions we don't have. But something has to be done. And finance has assured us, has told us, that this is also a matter that they're, you know, they're looking into. We have to fix this.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. You presented to me a litany of problems. I beg to differ. Because the facts presented to me proved contrary to the litany you gave me. Because you came to office September 2nd, you rectified that iteration.
Yeah.
So it's in the burden. Stanley Consulting has defaulted. So as you said, there is no bid because as part of the supervisory contract that is being given to Senate Consultant was unable to prepare a bid. So there's no bid document yet. The ministry has attempted to recruit another consultant. We don't know where you finalize the recruitment of that consultant. And that consultant will be charged with the responsibility of providing the bid document. The reliance that the ministry has now is the Monrovia Buchanan Highway as the raison d'etre to maybe award this contract.
I'm sorry, Senator.
What this speaks to, Madam, sure, and I don't like to call names, but I've done my research. Mm-hmm. I've spoken to, don't forget, Chair of Foreign Relations. So I've spoken to individuals attached to this road project.
Okay.
And the delay in getting this project up falls in the lap of the Minister of Works. Her inability to do work as speedily as possible is what has given Public Works the problem. So there's absolutely no reason. And let me remind you, Madam Minister, that from the day we rectified that instrument, which is $50 million. Mm-hmm. The government of Liberia starts to pay commitment fees. The people of Liberia paying money for no work being done. For us, as politicians, it makes us look like we are liars. Because I go to Maryland, go to the Southeast, and tell my people, we rectify on the 2nd of September, the road starts in January. January comes, nothing. February, nothing. It doesn't tell us you say, look at all the liars coming down the road. We become now prey single of the Johnson Sirleaf government. Look, I'm from the opposition, but I don't take the line of the opposition because sometimes it better be much more constructive. So you need to do much better at that ministry with those persons called engineers than engineers. Because, I mean, this borders on the integrity of us. And if we are short-circuited, we're giving gashes instead of the hole, it becomes difficult. Secondly, I hate to go through this that I'm going through with you. And that's why we request them to support them this meeting with Public Works on their alleged bribery. We didn't want to come in the public domain to say some of the things that we have to say. That's why I wrote to you, Madam Minister, requesting that you investigate. You've been given a haphazard document they call report. I have a copy. You understand? When you receive a copy, and Mr. Protean, please give me an opportunity to read this piece of document. When you receive a document like this, and it's addressed to the Honorable Justin Greening, Cabinet Minister of State, for DFID, the Department of International Development. And it states, I wish to launch serious happiness in Liberia, and as Minister of DFID, while supporting various projects in this newly democratic governed country of Liberia, I believe you should know what is happening to people of Britain who choose to contract to the Liberian people. The wrongdoing of extortion against British contractors and the worker is not in our code of conduct and are not acceptable. Payments are being interrupted by Liberian Ministry of Public Works engineers demanding large payments from project managers before they will issue the engineering certificates to progress payment. Theft and violence has been used against British contractors, plant and staff, to stress to make payments. When you receive documents like this, as Chair of Foreign Relations, it's our responsibility. We have to raise the issue. There are other compelling documents that we have, Madam Minister. The last one that prompted me into action was this last one. From Mr. Carlson, yes. He said, "Dear Senator, May 15th, dear Senator, you know we make promises of intervention. That's our responsibility. Please be like we protect the image of Liberia." So we asked them to do this. On May 15th, I received a communication. "Dear Senator, I've talked to the Minister of State for DFID, Justin." Greeny, who is now in the picture of our flight to get what is due to us from contacts in Maryland, Brandon. We should have been dispersed from our letter of credit with the LBDI bank. And the letter of credit is here. I have a meeting in the House of Commons with Minister of State for DFID on the 5th of June, 2-3 days from now. So I will be very pleased to report movement of my demand for payment before the state. Like this, our responsibility is to protect the image of our country. And when we get to you, you provide us information, we can provide this to others. We continue to hold on that it's a need for a comprehensive investigation. I'm not prepared to shame Liberia anymore. But just as you charged to work for a government of Liberia, I'm charged to do my work too. There's a serious problem in your ministry. Your ability to answer the letters that are pressing will cause this country a lot. I don't know when last you were on the battles with the Somalia tribe. The police are all working. The police are all working. Every day there's a problem. How do we go out to defend the image of our government? When it rings, they ring on everybody's house here. I pray, Madam Minister, that, and I beg the indulgence of the pro tem. Mr. Pro Tem, we can't exhaust all of these documents today with the minister. I have their response, and I have also the response from Mr. Carson to that five-page letter. I wish not to call the public works official names in this document.
I think that would help.
No, that will not help. The laws of Liberia provide somebody that is presumed innocent.
Yes.
Until proven guilty in a court of competent jurisdiction. To divulge these names here with all them being proven guilty or not will not be fair to the character of the
individual. But we're making case in the news.
No, we will not do it because the minister is under obligation to give us an opportunity to first discuss this issue before calling people names. And that's what I pray for. I pray that we meet to have these things discussed because it borders on the integrity of the people of the Republic of Liberia in this image. Please let me conclude. I will. I've been an administrator, so I will not indict anybody. What I want to say here. You are on obligation to answer letters from us. You are on obligation to address issues. Each and every one of us serve on committee as either labor matter at the Ministry of Public Works, the chair on labor will call you. Because you will be able to provide the information. I will fall short of describing the public works as being public works as being incompetent. I will fall short of that. I will not do that. But we are on the borders
of just that. My appeal, I appeal to the Honorable Liberian Legislature, I mean Liberian Senate, that this matter is taken up seriously by you, so that we can find it and trade. I got one information, you got one information, and let's arrive at a solution that we can present to the parliamentarians so that they can save by the distress.
Senator will ask for those in the general
Distinguished police, Senator Branko, please have your seat, man, please. Okay, distinguished colleagues, it's been a long day, and I think the day will get longer because this issue is grave. As I sat here, I was kind of perplexed. And in my perplexity, I've been having some serious thoughts. And what are these thoughts? You know, when the President of the Republic of Liberia comes to address us at the nation's address, I remember the 5 hours, and she was standing and telling us achievements, the projections, the rules, when this will happen. I believed in my own mind it was with the acquiescence of the different ministries that based a border on her speech of addressing the nation. And so I am wondering as to whether that speech to the nation was based on falsehoods from the various ministries, as clearly been shown here today. In my confused state, I also wonder whether they hold cabinet meetings. And if they do, what are those things, issues of priority that are discussed in cabinet meetings? That's a serious answer I want to have. Now, having said that, I want to take us back to our predecessor of the Public Health Ministry. Because as I sat here and listened, but my minister always referred to, I wasn't there, predecessor, for maybe 10 months. I believe the ministry is an institution that has deputy ministers, all the different ministers for a particular affair. And I would say that in the spirit of continuation, there must have been all these issues placed before the minister. But at the same time, the challenges are so enormous. And listening to the minister saying, yes, it's true what you say, their role may not happen, this may not happen, then I believe that the minister cannot take the challenge. She's unable to perform this function yet. And so in my own mind, if the minister is not giving the right resources or the materials or the power of Anthony to perform, I think she should do the right thing to step aside and quit the job because of her own character. Because what is happening here is the blame will be on the Minister of Public Works. I've listened to all the speakers, and I'm under obligation to say this minister is in a catch 22 situation that she cannot see herself out. Since 10 months ago, we have not had a pictorial of why the Ministry of Public Works is taking us as it relates to rules and other issues that raised to be. Yeah. Everywhere there is problem. Ali, zero. Zuni, zero. Filler Road, zero. Gentlemen, ladies, from zero to zero are complete zeros. So I will say here today that if there is an issue with the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Public Works, hey, they gotta start talking about it so that this issue can be brought to rest. As it relates to what is happening in Sasna, I mean Grand Crew and Sano, I apologize. that as soon as possible with all these things that we are discussing today. If you look in this document, Monserrado ELW Community Infrastructure Development Project, US $5.6 million were approved. $2.2 million was disbursed. You want to tell me, do I know what is happening on ELW Road? Nothing is happening there. And so if we have contractors who these roads have been contracted to, and it was done by the predecessor, then calling on an audit for the predecessor to tell us what happened to these contracts. People cannot resign and go scot-free and leave unfinished business and expect a minister that does not have the full authority to complete this. And so I will be saying to this minister, if there are no resources and there are nothing to work with, please resign. Because we will not continue to be accountable to our people with lies when nothing is ever going to happen. We cannot continue to say senators, representatives must take money from the pockets to build roads. That's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is oversight. And ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. This oversight that we have, how powerful is this oversight when people do not respond to us, when we cannot get them to appear, when we cannot get no answers? What do we do in this situation? It's about time that this Senate muster the courage. Muster the courage, like you see the health workers doing, to make sure that we do something. We need to set up a blockade on the executive and the ministers to make sure that we're serious. They have to answer these questions. They have to tell us what is happening so that we can be able to explain to our people what I'm seeing here, what I'm hearing here, with no mince of my words. I don't believe that this minister is incompetent, but I believe that her hands are tied at her back and she's thrown in the water. The whole thing is very ambiguous. And this issue is ambiguous because what is happening? We are going around in cycle, hey man, historical air. But let me just tell you what today. This issue is grave. There are a lot of allegations, counter allegations and counter claims. The minister can start it today. She in the water. And what we had to do today is to make sure we talk for in the water honorably. Madam President, you gave me this challenge, man. I got nothing to work with. The issue of public work is one of those challenges that the government is saying to us, we're going to build roads. Yeah. You know what road does for us? It increase our economy. Yeah. It empower the people. Yeah. You talk about NPA buses. You just get 10 buses, we don't want more. It's for why? Buy roads. Buy roads affect healthcare. Buy roads affect education. Buy roads affect everything. Fellow Liberians, this is the time to act and make sure that we take our dear minister for in the water. I submit.
So how was that for that now?
I am coming to turn now.
Oh, Satya. Man.
Satya.
The most powerful speech in my life, I've heard. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Welcome to 2017.
Yes.
Lord Engineer, and I see that the whole situation is confusing because we are talking about loans that were done, that are not being paid for. We're talking about existing contracts. We're talking about new contracts. So we have to be very realistic. We have to be real. We have to be fair to the Liberian people. If there's a problem, we need to come out and see what the problem is, or if there are problems. If there's no money, say there's no money. If it's a capacity problem, say capacity problem. We don't have the engineers to do these things. Because everything that you're listing sounds very unrealistic. Because I think we have over 4 or 5 major roads that we are spoken about. I feel very bad because I see that you have the vehicle to work and I know what you're going through, but you have to come out and say actually what those issues are, what those challenges are. If we need to restructure, because there's no way you can continue going when you have other big problems. If we have to restructure some of these contracts and prioritize and communicate that to the Liberian people, because PR is also important. You didn't have to come here today if you are communicating all these things on the radio. with your senators, with your representatives, our people who have been informed and aware of the status of all of you roads that we are talking about. So I want to advise you, you and your team, I think it's time to go back on all of the contracts. Let's do some restructuring and do a presentation, new presentation. Let's see roads that are doable. Let's see what is realistic instead of us talking, because it sounds like rhetoric now to the Liberian people. If the problems are there, let's lay them out and let all of us to communicate. Secondly, this country has a lot of issues. So much issues until some of those issues are read like bedtime stories to kids. So everybody knows the issues. And for us to move any further in moving the country forward, we have to cooperate, we have to collaborate, and we need people with excellent, very excellent interpersonal orientation. If you don't have that, there's no way we can achieve, there's no way you can connect with people who should be partners to you. Especially senators, representatives, these people should be your partners. How can they help you if you're not opening those doors? So I want to encourage you to exhibit that excellent interpersonal orientation. I think you know what it means when they say reciprocal determination. That's the only way we can succeed. So if you look at that, then
we can all succeed. What's wrong with that? What's wrong?
Motion for continuity.